Shalom, Israel. This is Brother Nala with another edition of Nala's Chamber, a long overdue episode, but back in full effect. Today's topic will be entitled, The Power of Television. The Power of Television. Mainly with the thought of my childhood, because I'm speaking from my perspective of growing up in my earliest memories in the 1980s leading up to the 1990s and to the early 1990s. Majority of it, my focus is going to be on the 80s for several different reasons. That was the age of my earliest development of memory in the 1980s, and also it just so happens to coincide with the peak of television sitcoms. I mean, there's been sitcoms on television since the Honeymooners in the 50s, when sitcoms were actually filmed live. When you watched it then, it was actually live television because television was new. So they treated it like almost like a play where they had to, before they even recorded it, they had to, you saw it as it happened. But the 80s were at its peak, had the most, it predates the cable. Yes, cable was out, but it predates cable surpassing regular TV. So you had three networks, CBS, NBC, and ABC were the main primary channels. Stations in the 80s. Fox came on a little later, but you had the three networks and they had pretty much the whole country on lock. So when you think about that, any given show, primetime show, was seen by millions. Even the lowest of ratings will still have millions of people watching it. So you can imagine the more popular shows, what the audiences were like. So with that said, before I get into the heart of the matter, I just want to touch on a specific individual from earlier in that time. He's actually from the 70s, but he was a very instrumental black man that really was groundbreaking to break that world, because television, especially in the 80s, in the 70s, and before that, were predominantly white. I can even remember early childhood memories of sitting with my family, mother and father, watching Family Feud, and how excited they would get when a black family was on the Family Feud, because they're from an era where every time a black person would come on TV, people would call each other, from what they told me, and they still had that in them. Even in the 80s, where you saw black people on TV and they would get excited and people would call each other. That's how crazy it was back then, as far as having no black people on screen, that it was a big deal to see a black person's face on the Family Feud. But to get into a specific individual from that time, a man named Eric Monte, who was from Chicago, the Cabrini-Green Projects, and he moved to LA to pursue a career in screenwriting. And his first sell of one of his ideas was The Jeffersons, when he created the Jefferson family. And he was actually, he got an N because in his move to LA, he met up with a man named Mike Evans, who was an actor. So he basically saw that as an opportunity to sell one of his scripts, because Mike Evans booked the job on All in the Family. And he booked the job because Eric Monte tried to sell the script to Norman Lear in his company as the Jeffersons, upper class family in New York. And instead of making its own series at first, the Jeffersons came through All in the Family at first. then it became its own series. So, and it became very popular. So Eric Monte created the Jeffersons. Shortly after the Jeffersons, he had another script sold, which was a very classic black movie from the 70s called Cooley High, which was loosely based on his life. The character Preach, played by the actor Glenn Turman, was based upon him, Eric Monte, because he was a writer, and then Preach was a writer, which became a underground hit amongst black people, and now it's a classic in general. So he had two hits during the mid-70s, Jeffersons, which became its own series, and Cooley High. Then, because Cooley High was a sleeper hit, it didn't cost a lot of money to make. Filmed in Chicago, in the inner city, and through that, through the success of the Jeffersons and Cooley High, he decided to make Cooley High into a sitcom. So when he sold it, I believe to a company called Embassy, they remixed it and said, well, Cooley High is a little too deep, a little too hard edge to be a sitcom. We would have to like revamp it. So they sort of rearranged things in Cooley High. The character of Preach became Roger. So it wasn't directly based off Cooley High. It was sort of a loosely based version of Cooley High, with Roger being sort of like a different Preach character, sort of remix. And instead of Chicago, they had it in Los Angeles. And they added characters like Rerun and Dwayne, sort of to mimic Preach's character. He had two friends. But Rerun and Dwayne, that was made for TV to soften it up, where Rerun and Dwayne are like clown characters. Rerun is a big, fat, jolly guy that can dance, and Dwayne is kind of like an airhead, but that's funny, that's funny. And then Raj is kind of the smart one that writes. So what's happening was another hit. So he's on a roll now at this point, and then he creates another, sells another script in the 70s around that same time called Good Times, which was another, probably the biggest hit associated with black people in the 70s, legendary. It's probably a tie between that and the Jeffersons, but Good Times is more remembered because it had a more realistic edge to it, because the Jeffersons is like almost fictional, that there's not many black rich people living in the Upper East Side of Manhattan during that time, where there were housing project life in the 70s, which reflected in Good Times. So that became a hit through Norman Lear, the same guy that made the Jeffersons. So without further ado, I'll let the man speak in his own words to tell you exactly what happened with him and how he created all these shows. And literally, he was like another version of those big producers like Aaron Spelling and Norman Lear, yet he should be considered to be a legend, but nobody even really knows who Eric Monte is. You might have saw his name in the credits, but you don't realize that are those three between the Jeffersons, What's Happening, and Good Times. That is like three major classics. That, you know, how many people can do that? But yet this man ended up broke. And you'll see in his words how that happened.
The Writers Guild only wanted to pay me minimum, okay? And what's happening was based on Cooley High. So I should have got whatever I wanted for What's Happening. So ABC, Mike Eisner called me in, and they wanted to do a series based on Cooley High. So I said, okay, but I don't want to go through what I went through at Norman Lear, the Tandem Production. So I wanted to produce it under my own production company. And I'm not mad at him for taking the Jeffersons. He can have that. I'm going to produce under my own production company. I'll make buku money. So they said, okay, but you've never produced. So you need some line producers. So I said, okay. So they said, your agent, Bernie Weintraub, he represents these two line producers, Saul Turtletaub and Bernie Ornstein. We want to use them. So I said, okay. So I wrote a script, the pilot script for What's Happening. Turned it in to ABC. They accepted it. Okay. When they set up the offices, it said Toy Production. And I was like, who the hell is Toy Production? Turtletaub and Ornstein had gone out and formed a company with Bud York and Norman Lear's partner. ABC had signed to do the show with that company, and my agent, Bernie Weintraub, had negotiated the deal all behind my back.
And these are the same Ornstein and Weintraub that did Sanford and Son.
Yes. So I went to the Writers Guild, and the Writers Guild was into, okay, we can get you minimal. Because I had proof that I created Good Times, that I created George and Louisa Jefferson, that I created What's Happening.
Just by the sheer fact that you created those characters entitled you
to pay.
Even if you didn't work on the Jefferson series,
right,
the fact
right.
that you created those characters.
Right. Okay. So, but Norman Lear hadn't put my name on the credits at all, and I had proof. But the guild was into, we can get you minimal. And I felt I deserved more than minimum. So I filed a suit against ABC, CBS, Saul Turtletaub, Bernie Ornstein, Bud Yorkin, Norman Lear, Bernie Weintraub. I filed a lawsuit against them. So that's what happened. So at the end, my lawyers that were representing me, Norman Lear came to me and he offered me $1 million for a settlement. And I said, for all those shows, no way. So the lawyers came to me and they said, look, take that money because you still have your suit against the networks and the others, but at least we'll get paid. So I said, okay. He offered me $1 million at one point in Good Times. So I said, okay. So when the papers came down, all the defendants were listed. So I said, I didn't agree to this. They said, either you take this or we're walking off the case. This was 1 week before the Statue of Limitations ran out. I went all over Los Angeles looking for lawyers to represent me. I had the evidence and everything, okay? No lawyer in that town would take my case. So about 3 days, and I didn't have the legal skills to go against Norman Lear and CBS's lawyer in court, even though I had the evidence, because you can lose a case on the technicality.
Okay. So this is the consequence of standing up for yourself.
And that was the consequence. And no, none of this.
The DVDs are still in circulation.
I know. The show is still.
The
Cosby, too.
The actors don't make money.
Yeah, I know.
It's just.
Yeah. Norman Lear is a racist, a hypocrite, a thief, and a liar.
So, as you heard, basically, people that run Hollywood, just get right to it, is Amalek. And even his own agent and people that were on his own team, his own management team, they were Amalekites too. And they got together and basically pulled the rug out of his feet, from under his feet. I mean, that is it's a stereotype from the days of older rock and roll, when you see Cadillac Records with Muddy Waters, Howlin' Wolf, and John Lee Hooker and all those early rock guys got Etta James. You know, they made a movie called Cadillac Records about that, how they got cheated out of their money, their talents got used. It's because our people, I mean, he was from Eric Monty's from the Projects. I mean, they go in, to make a long story short, our people go in thinking Esau is fair dealing and you'll pay me what I'm worth. And what they'll do is they'll give you a lot of money up front, but then they'll make a ton of money under your nose. By the time you realize it, it's too late. They've already in court figured out a way that you don't own what you wrote. And Even the people that are supposed to be on your team are Amalek as well, and they team up together. And they feel like the average Jake like that is too dumb to even realize what he's sitting on. It's like sitting on a treasure of gold, and you don't even realize the treasure you're sitting on and what it's worth. So that is the quick story of Eric Monte, an unsung hero that the average person probably doesn't even know who he is. And he created three monumental sitcoms in the 70s that to this day that are still, as he said, still on the air. But that's just a little side story. That's a whole different commentary about how Amalek took advantage of a history of show business, taking advantage of Jake and Eve in this business. But I'll get on to the main topic, which is the power of television. Coming from my point of view, from being a young baby child, 5, 6, 7 years old, watching TV and having your mind developed around that during your developmental years, and how that can affect your, have a profound effect on what you see, how this thing called TV is a window into a world that as a child you trying to figure out what life is and what people are, and this is the tool that literally is programming your mind. So with that said, my earliest memories of watching TV as far as sitcoms is Eight Is Enough. It's probably a sitcom called Eight Is Enough about this single father raising eight kids that ranging from like a little 8-year-old boy all the way up to like kids in their late teens. And once again, that set the tone for Esau, like wherever these, being the, as I probably was like, remember watching it maybe at 4 or 5 years old, looking at these Edomite people, thinking where they are is somehow peaceful, and they're all crammed into this house together, and they all seem to be happy, and things are a main thing they all have in common is that they're all in suburbia, where their homes, and it's clean, and it's the American suburb. And growing up in Brooklyn, American suburbs was something you only see on TV. All what I grew up around was project buildings and tenement buildings, and you know, random apartment buildings here and there, but suburbia was something that was almost fictional to me. So that is the first sitcom of my memory, a sitcom called Eight Is Enough, starring Dick Van Patten, who was the lead actor in that, and played the father. Another sitcom I remember, and this is one really had a big impact on me, around the same age, 5 years old, 6 years old, was a show called Silver Spoons. And the lead child actor was a blonde-haired, blue-eyed, white kid named Ricky Schroeder. And I remember that one had an effect on me because the basic synopsis of the show is this kid, Ricky, he actually used his real first name in the show. His name was Ricky Stratton in the show. Ricky Schroeder playing Ricky Stratton, decides he's going to live with his father, and his mother and father were divorced. His father is the heir to this big toy company, the Stratton Toy Company, that he inherited from his father. So basically, there's somewhere upstate or Connecticut, somewhere not far from New York, I remember. There's somewhere on the northeast. Believe it might be upstate or Connecticut. And they have this big mansion, and he's a toy maker. So that's going to naturally pique your interest as a child. So his house is full of toys. They have a train, model that you can sit in and ride that goes from outside the house, inside the house. He has toys everywhere. And his bed is made of, it's like a race car bed. So as a kid, that really struck me because I was like, wow, Edomites live like that. You know, obviously I didn't think about it in detail, but I'm looking at white kids and I'm like, is that what they are? They just rich and happy and living this looks like a kid's dream or paradise. Basically, Silver Spoons was just a live action version of Richie Rich. His name is even Ricky, so it sounds like Richie. Richie Rich was a cartoon about a kid that just was extremely rich. Like everything was money oriented. He was the richest kid in the world. And Silver Spoons was like a takeoff of Richie Rich, the same way how What's Happening was a takeoff of Coolie High, but not exactly. Silver Spoons was a takeoff of Richie Rich, this a live action version, but it wasn't connected to it. They just kind of ripped the idea and made it their own. But I remember me and my childhood friends in kindergarten, first grade, and even older kids, we all envied Ricky Stratton, aka Ricky Schroeder, because he lived in a house that was full of toys and video games. And he did have one black friend, Alfonso Ribeiro, that eventually became Carlton from The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. But that was his first major series. So even living through him, and then ironically, he happens to be Trinidadian too, but that's a different story. But he was something you look at to, wow, he has a black friend. So subconsciously you're thinking, that could be me. I wish I was his friend. You know, so mind you, once again, as a child, you're receiving all this information, you're receiving all this stuff, and it's shaping your brain. Another sitcom that was big in my childhood was Who's the Boss, with Tony Danza playing the lead, where an Italian guy from Brooklyn, who's a widow, his wife died, he has one daughter that's about, she was probably 10 at the time, they move. He takes this housekeeping job in Connecticut, and they move in with this, once again, these all things take place in the suburbs. He moves into the suburbs, and eventually she accepts him as the housekeeper. So it's what happens when the Italian guy from Brooklyn goes to the suburbs and lives the life of housekeeper. Same thing. Like, it's like, okay, wherever Edomites are, it's heaven. Even the darker Edomites, which is Southern Italian, Sicilian, which Tony Danza is, and he is from Brooklyn. He's actually from Brownsville, actually. Even they can graduate to the real blonde hair Aryan Edomite. And wherever they live is heavenly. And he's coming from Brooklyn, where it's rough. So even that is putting subliminal minds in your head. And it's funny because I grew up in Brooklyn. So as I'm watching this, I'm like, damn, he went from Brooklyn to Connecticut and he lives like that. Once again, this is all shaping your mind as a kid. You don't realize how deep it is at that age. You start accepting like that reality where these Caucasians live is heaven and where you live is hell. So another show that comes to mind is Family Ties. Once again, another wholesome show about a family where you have a Michael J. Fox was the main star, and that show became so major that that's what led up to Back to the Future. When Steven Spielberg and Robert Zemeckis made Back to the Future, he was the main guy they wanted to play that, because he represents that suburban heaven. And then Back to the Future goes back to 1955 in not only a suburban heaven, the start of the suburban life, but also it predates the Civil Rights Movement, and then it's after World War II. So the reason why people love Back to the Future so much is because of the time. It was white people in their most golden era. There was no war, the war was over, and the Civil Rights Movement hasn't happened yet. So the mid-50s is right. Is laid perfectly right where it is, and it's just like the most wholesome era. So that's why to this day that movie is almost going on 40 years old now, Back to the Future, and came out in 1985. Of course, that's the year, you know, where he's trying to always get back to. between 1955 and 1985, family ties in with that, because they're putting you this wholesome character of Michael J. Fox, where he's all American, and Back to the Future is an all American movie during an all American time. And that also kind of lines up with Happy Days, the same thing as Back to the Future. It's a show that was made in the late 70s until it spilled off into the 80s, the early 80s. And it's about the 50s where that they were happy days. So it's because of that reason. Before the Civil Rights Movement and after World War II, when suburban life was really starting to pick up and the nuclear family was there. And that's the epicenter of like white heaven. It's the time when America finally got to the place where they dreamed it would be. Suburbia, white life, house, car, dog. The interstate roads have been paved, you know, so everything is running well. Another show that was big during that time was Growing Pains. Once again, Long Island, suburbia. The family's there. The family structure's solid. Everything is peaceful. They have problems, of course, because that's why it's called situation comedy. They have to get out of the situation. But that's what they are, situations. They're not dire straits. And everything resolved within a half an hour. And that's another major one where you see, like, wow, where they are. They're in Long Island, New York. The part of New York they're in is peaceful and heavenly and no crime, no issues. Everything is just wonderful. And even I remember an episode, even as a kid, there's this little racist comment these little writers make about a black guy. It's a basketball joke because the character Kirk Cameron played character Mike Seaver, and he was cheating on his test, and he wrote the answers on the bottom of his shoe. And you could see what the joke was.
Why is that feeding me shoes?
Ben, that's my bag.
Why is that feeding you shoes?
Ben, come on, give it. I need that.
Robert E. Lee, Stonewall Jackson, Appomattox Courthouse.
Yeah, they're my buddies. I have them sign them for good luck.
Do you know somebody named Appomattox Courthouse?
Yeah, a black guy, captain of the basketball team.
So as you can see, these writers are slick and funny, you know, and they're always going to take a jab at Jake. But anyway, and shortly after that, another show popped up, Full House. Once again, suburbia, San Francisco, everything. A guy's living by himself. He just lost his wife. He moves his two friends in. And they take care of their daughters. And once again, everything is happy, and where Edomites are, San Francisco looks peaceful. They live near the Golden Gate Bridge, and they're in heaven. And that show was a very major show in the 80s and spilled over into the 90s. Mr. Belvedere, another show where suburban Pittsburgh, that's where it takes place, with Bob Uecker, who's a lead guy, and then they hired this British Christopher Hewitt, this guy from England, to be their butler, and he moves in the house. So they have suburban heaven with an English butler. So how much heaven is that? You live in a nice, quiet, peaceful neighborhood, and now you have even a British servant. It's like, once again, where Esau is, heaven is. Another show later in the 80s and spilled over to the 90s, Doogie Howser, M.D. I can't think of his name right now. It'll come to me in a second. But he is, Neil Patrick Harris is his name. Neil Patrick Harris is a 13, 14-year-old doctor. He's a genius living in suburbia, and somehow he's a medical doctor. So even the Edomite preteen, just barely into his teen, has graduated medical school already. So imagine these are all the images that are being put in your brain over the course of a childhood. Another honorable mention, Charles in Charge. Once again, another guy from, they have this thing where guys from Brooklyn, and that main actor, Scott Baio, he's actually from Brooklyn. He's from Bensonhurst, and he goes to some suburban neighborhood and becomes like the babysitter to these two teenage girls and one 11-year-old boy, and he's in charge of the house. Once again, you take a darker Edomite, an Italian, put him in a white suburbia, and somehow he's even in a heaven, you know? So just to name a couple of movies that were big in my childhood with that, where Esau is heaven. The Goonies was major amongst me and the childhood friends and peers I grew up with. And that particular movie, it was universal, where I remember having many conversations about The Goonies because it's a classic, and how we were always envious that why can't we go on adventures like that? They can go find a tunnel into a buried treasure and on a pirate ship, and somehow that only happens to them. So whatever happens to them seems to be like only good fortune and stuff happens to them. Like, if you're black, the world has it, or the God or the universe has it, where you couldn't even get in a situation like that. That only happens where they are. So I remember us loving that movie, Goonies, but envying them that we want to go on a treasure hunt and we want to find a pirate treasure. I remember even a childhood memory of us wanting that so bad that in Brooklyn we have a park called Fort Greene Park. It's in the Fort Greene section of Brooklyn. And ironically, we have there's a Washington Memorial there, and there is an underground burial ground for certain soldiers from the Revolutionary War. And we were so pumped up from watching the Goonies that we were trying to get in. It's a massive mausoleum buried under Fort Greene Park. And we wanted to find our way inside of that mausoleum that we thought some kind of treasure or something was there after we watched the Goonies so much. This even affect Michael Jackson, as far as my point being of this whole thing is you're seeing these images and it's making you reflect back at yourself, and you're feeling like somehow where you are is inferior to them, which is a part of propaganda. It's a part of white supremacy. It's the entertainment arm of it. It even affected Michael Jackson, because as we all know about Michael Jackson's life story, that he had to work as a child, as an entertainer for so many years, that psychologically he felt like he missed his childhood. But that was his era when all those shows were out, his era of being famous. So he was into all those shows and movies as well. And you see how close he got with Macaulay Culkin, because this movie came out in 1990, Home Alone. Once again, suburbia, a bunch of kids and their parents go on a trip. They leave the main character, Kevin, home alone. They forget he got mischievous and didn't make the flight. And then he goes in his own little adventure within his own house against these burglars. And Michael Jackson is just eating this up to the point where he got obsessed with Macaulay Culkin. He has the power to actually hang out with him. So he pretty much befriended him and almost like he purchased him with his fame. And to go back to the Goonies, the same thing. He was into the same movie, to the point where Corey Feldman, one of the main characters' kids in the Goonies, got close to him too, because Michael Jackson just wanted to be a part of that world, the same illusion that we all fell for as children, thinking that that world was better. Yet he had the fame and money to actually have those kids around him, you know, what we, the same thought process we would have thought. That's how powerful it is as kids. We would have loved it if one of those characters from Home Alone or the Goonies were, came to our neighborhood and hung out with us. That would have been heaven. It's sad, but it's true. You know, now we know better. Like, no, we're the higher spirits. Like, they can't do anything for us. But as a kid, you're being fed these images and you think that somehow their lives are superior. And both of those, ironically, both of those actors, Macaulay Culkin and Corey Feldman, one played in Goonies, the other played in Home Alone, both had broken homes. So it was all an illusion. That's the, and so did Michael Jackson have a broken home. So it's funny how we're sold these images and it's not even real, you know. Another two examples that were big in my childhood is Different Strokes, of course. Once again, that was probably one of the biggest, I would say it has to be the biggest all-time childhood sitcom that from that era that affected our brain. Because once again, living in New York, two kids from Harlem get adopted by this white, rich, multimillionaire. He might have been even a billionaire. And living in Park Avenue on the penthouse top floor. And somehow he takes pity on these kids. His maid died and he, their father's out of the picture, and he adopts them as his own sons. And as a child, you're watching this and you're thinking, wow, wherever this white man is heaven. And even the apartment they live in is the top floor. It's like you're going up to heaven. There were these marble staircases and everything looks all white and shiny and pristine. And it's so ironic that you have that image being the guy that played the Arnold, Gary Coleman, became the highest paid actor of that time. And not only that, he's always in number one on the list of the most famous childhood actors of all time. And then that heaven that we thought we were, all three of those main kids on the show, Willis, Todd Bridges, got hooked on crack. Dana Plato, she died of an overdose. And Gary Coleman went broke, bankrupt several times, and then died. He married a white woman and she pushed him down a flight of stairs. She said he fell and he ended up breaking his neck and dying. So the things that we would covet as children, it was a false image. And every time you see, when you know the real story, we were just sold a bunch of lies, but it so affected our childhood as far as us thinking that world was better. And the real irony is the biggest 80s show of all time happened to be a black show where they were living well. The Cosby Show. It broke all the records. It literally is the champion of the most highest rated, most made the most money for any network in the whole entire 80s decade. And it was a black show, which the country is majority white. Yet all this, the majority of the viewers, I think they average like 30 to 50 million people per episode, which is, that would never happen today because there's so much stuff to watch now. But that was amazing that a black family can be in so many households at the, in one night for half an hour. So it was mind-blowing, and that's why they had to destroy it. But to wrap things up, when you mention before I wrap it up, we also this is going towards the early 90s, we're fed a lot of imagery that I feel like Jake and Eve had to were mesmerized by, as far as the early 90s of the Beverly Hills 90210, which for me particular, I remember going to school with 10 Tribes girls, and that's Puerto Ricans, Ephraim, and Simeonites, Dominicans, and they were in love with two characters, Jason Priestley and Luke Perry from 90210, and they really, the 10 tribes really loved that show because sort of they think they can sort of look like them, and they really idolized them, and they really would, you had girls having their posters on their books and their school books and on their lockers and stuff like that of these men in a world, and these are girls in the hood, a world that doesn't exist for them. But that's how much that imagery really really was strong, and how it affects us to this day. That's why people from my generation, a lot of them grew up to fantasize about the Edomite women from watching Christina Applegate on Married with Children, or watching Pamela Anderson on Baywatch, or watching the girl that played in Boy Meets World. Her character's name was Topanga. I knew kids my age that were loving that white girl. And, you know, even before my generation, watching the Brady Bunch with Marsha Brady, like people lusting after her. And that totally, when that world is not accessible to you and it's presented to you that way, you start to deify it and to put it on the pedestal like it's magic. And then we get Good Times and everything is broken down, and Sanford and Son, and things, even in that fantasy world, things are looking disheveled. This would have to be another commentary, but just to touch on it real quick, to fast forward to modern times, you have the reason why there's no more sitcoms is because of an economic thing where reality TV, you don't have to even pay them that much to your cast of characters, yet still get the same ratings and still get the commercial revenue that you would to a sitcom. So you don't have sitcom celebrities that want millions of dollars a piece, where you have, let's say, a show like Love and Hip Hop, where you can pay them $1,000 per season, or a couple of thousand, they'll be happy with that because they're getting clout and they're on TV. And if they don't want the money, you just pick somebody else. They're easily dispendable. And just like in the blaxploitation era, black people are used as very cheap work and making a lot of people a whole lot of money. The same thing that happened to Eric Monte is still going on to this very day. And on top of that, our imagery through even Love and Hip Hop is 50 times worse than just showing poverty from Good Times and What's Happening and all those Sanford and Son, showing us impoverished state. Now we're in a wild, ratchet state. So this the power of television to conduct these images is very strong and has a lasting impression. And I think the Most High, that even developing as a child, having those envious thoughts about like wishing I could live in that heaven of suburbia and go on adventures with Esau, that I was able to see the light and say, well, this is not real. You know, I was lied to as a child. And, you know, and it comes in the form of this commentary of reflective way, thinking about childhood and thinking about how much you were influenced by what you saw on TV. So that is another, this has been another edition of Nala's Chamber. I hopefully won't stay away that long as far as making commentaries, but it was just a lot of dealing with the regular camp videos. But I'll try to be definitely more frequent with the Nala's Chambers videos. Hope you enjoyed another Nala's Chamber. Make sure you like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell for future episodes. And with that, I bid you shalom.